I don't know what the show is.
Why do we play with fire?
What if the workshop happens and nothing changes? What then, Jonathan?
Maybe I'm just wasting my time.
Do you know how many Jonathan Larsons there are? One.
Why should we blaze a trail?
There's not enough time. I went to 3 friends' funerals last year, and nobody is doing enough. I'm not doing enough.
Try writing about what you know.
What does it take to wake up a generation?
It would be a tragedy to give up what you have.
Take off and fly. Fear or love, baby, don't say the answer. Actions speak louder than
words.
Inspiration that you had here, because Jonathan Larson was so instrumental in your own career and aspirations, I think.
Absolutely. I saw Rent on January 16th, 1997. I remember because it was a birthday present from my girlfriend. We sat in the last row of the mezzanine of the, not the Rich Brothers, that's my theater, the Nederlander Theater on 40th Street, and it was, again, it felt like a personal attack. All I ever wanted to do was write songs and make movies, and here's Mark and Roger, and they want to write songs and make movies, and it also, it felt, it was the most contemporary score I'd ever heard, it was the most contemporary version of New York I'd ever seen in a musical. It was the most diverse cast I'd ever seen on Broadway. It actually looked like the city I really live in. And it was the show that gave me permission. It just felt homemade, and it spoke to my concerns and my fears and my hopes. So I do it. I'm dumb enough to do it. I go study theater in college, and then I'm a senior in college at Wesleyan University, you know, they've made a production, an off-Broadway production of an early work of his called Tick, Tick, Boom. It was adapted by playwright David Auburn and directed by Scott Schwartz and turned into a 3-person show. And I think it's my first time downtown since the attacks of September 11th. It's like October, November 2001. And if I thought Rent was a personal attack, here is the brilliant Raul Esparza playing Jonathan Larson. Yes, woo! Jeremy Dixon, Andy Spanger, and it's even more personal. It's the same concerns, but even more concentrated. And, you know, I don't know what anyone else experienced at that show. For me, it was like, hi, Lynn, in the 10th row. It's Jonathan Larson. This is going to be a lot harder than you think. And that pretty girl sitting next to you is not going to be your girlfriend anymore. And she studied acting, but she's going to get a real job because she's going to get fed up with all the rejection that comes with acting. And all your friends who are studying to be filmmakers, theater makers, they're all going to get real jobs. And it's just going to be you banging your head against your childhood dream, and the world might not notice while you're alive that you're making this stuff. Do you still want to do this? And it was very clarifying for me because I felt like after a long walk after that show, I think I walked home to Washington Heights all the way from 14th Street. I just went away. My date that night was like, yeah, you just said, I gotta go, and stumbled out of the theater. And but it clarified my resolve, and I was like, I'm okay doing this. I'm okay that this is a calling. And if I'm lucky enough to get to spend my time doing this, then I will do it. And I wanted the film to have that, ask those same clarifying questions. There's no artists in here who ever questioned themselves, have they? No. Yes, I wanted to sort of be what it was for me.
Yeah, and it's amazing. I mentioned ensemble because it's truly a great ensemble cast you put together here. Yeah, and they recognize it here, too. Let me start with you, Andrew. I don't believe you were known as a singer, to my knowledge of your career, before this film. Many different things. Broadway, obviously. I saw you on Death of a Salesman, actually, and all kinds of, theater, movies, television. But how did you prove yourself to be a singer to this guy, to get this role?
Oh gosh, I wasn't known as a singer to myself either. But Lynn has this strange ability to see things that other people can't see and things that you can't see in yourself. Lynn has an ability to dream unlike any 6-year-old I've ever met. Like, it's an incredible gift that he has, and it becomes contagious just by being around it. So for me, it kind of took his belief that kind of woke me up to a dream that I didn't even know I had, which was to access a singing voice and live in a musical for a while. I think I was too terrified to even own that dream. So it was like a dream came true that I didn't even know I had because of Lynn. And he had seen me in Angels in America, which, as we all know, probably is a 9-hour show. And
it gets longer every time you tell
it. 15-hour, 89 times a week. But to get through that vocally, obviously, is, six, seven, eight times a week is, it's a feat. And I think Lynn said, well, if you're not tone deaf, then vocally you can probably get to the place where Jonathan, got to in terms of, but the thing about Jonathan is that he sang to the back row of the galaxy, even if he was in his living room, working on whatever he was working on. So for me, what was more important, whether I sounded good or not, was up to Lynn and Liz Kaplan and all of my compatriots here and you guys, but for me, what was important was to get to that place where I imagined I sounded great. You know what I mean? Where I could fully sing with every single cell in my, with my soul coming out of my throat like Jonathan sang. Because Jonathan was singing for his life, for the life of his friends, and most specifically, of course, for the life of, it was life and death in a literal way, of course, for everyone around him that was getting sick and in lots of cases dying of AIDS, this lost generation of artists in New York at the time. So his music wasn't just music, it was transcendent. It was like that AIDS memorial quilt. It was a piece, he was making art that was fighting for the soul of his country and the soul of the individuals that were around him and for their very, for their heartbeats. So for me, it was like, I have to make sure that I can fully commit, fully embodied that Jonathan style of singing. And so Lynn was generous enough to provide me space and time and resources, and Liz Kaplan, who's an incredible singing teacher that I couldn't have done this without, and this incredible cast of, incredible musical theater thoroughbreds that I'm just in deep admiration of. And they all kind of grew this garden that I didn't know I had in me and allowed it to bloom with love and with care and with water and with a lot of attention. It was so I'm eternally indebted to Lynn and to everyone here for allowing that.
Good choice. I mean, that's really, it's a remarkable performance. I was at the premiere here in Hollywood, and everyone was walking out going, like, singing your praises here, and seeing a new part of your talents. It's really great. And Alexandra, terrific in this film. So what was this like for you, Alexandra, this experience everything this movie says about acting, about wanting this kind of a career, and there's Susan, who also seems to want more as well.
Well, I think what's really interesting is Susan and Michael define what success looks like for them and what failure looks like for them. So when she's saying, I want to go to Berkshires and I want to start teaching and really get back to training, that in I think a lot of ways looks like failure to Jonathan, who's like, I can't move away. Whereas for Susan, it's like a way in which she can and go and work on her craft and level up. And I think that as artists, we need these moments of reprieve, because if we're always going, we can get really exhausted and we can end up hurting ourselves even that much more. She just kept dancing at full capacity on an injury, on a hurt leg, then yeah, she was going to hurt herself. So I think that there's a lot that goes into the psyche of like tenacity and working really hard at what you're doing. And then just for me, I love the idea of being able to play someone who chooses themselves, who chooses their art, to be able to play a woman that is like, I love you so much, you go and take care of the things that you need to take care of, and I'm gonna go and take care of me. Like, there's so much power that is within that, and also so much love that goes for it too.
Yeah, and talk about Lynn as a director.
Terrible.
Not too bad.
Literally the best. I think that what is really fun, one of my favorite things about working with Lynn is that when we get on set, he has an idea about what he sees for this scene, and we come as actors with our own ideas and our own interpretations of the lines, and then it becomes a collaboration. And it's so much fun to be like, okay, and then what if she was like, and then it's like, oh yeah, that's gonna be so good. And Lynn's got his ideas of how he's gonna shoot it. And I'm like, okay, your camera's over there, make sure I hit my light. And like, hit my moment, you know what I mean? And it becomes this like double dutch back and forth collaboration that's just really fun and refreshing, and you get to set and you're ready to play. You know, like Andrew said, we get to play. We got to play with Lynn, and he was down to play with us, which is just like, oh, gag. I'm over at Old Play, let's go! Like, it's just the most fun. We have the most fun. And, like, do cool stuff. But it's fun. It has to be fun.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's the name of the game, too. Robin, you are a firecracker. It's so fun watching you on screen here too, and this role is so multi-dimensional too for you to play. I know you've worked with Lynn before, obviously on stage in The Heights, and talk about your experience here in playing this particular role.
Yeah, so for me, they call me Mr. Pig. Okay. Pumbaa in me, just like that's what allows me to just release. But for me, coming off of Boys in the Band, I wanted to be really, really intentional about what I did next, and you know, navigating being an out queer Latino since the beginning of my career. It's really interesting navigating the fact that, like, I feel like I'm always trying to claim my land back. Like, I was like, I'm gonna take this back from my ancestors and take this back. And what I mean by that is, you know, very rarely do I get to have an out gay character that is just so meaty and layered and, like, and full-bodied and that I actually get to play. And the bulk of my work is queer. But in filmmaking, sometimes it's hard for a gay man to get a gay role. So that was like the really cool thing about this character and the insertion of all my Latino and Black and Brown ancestors who were erased from HIV stories. Like, my mere presence, Lynn allowing me to be in this role, is like an insertion in time of my ancestors and my elders that I never got to meet. And so that was really cool. But also for Robin, I was looking to do something nuanced and subtle and completely different from Boys in the Band, because I know that I've always played big characters. And so I wanted to experience something more tethered that would allow me to showcase maturity. And so when I saw this, that was like what I saw. It was like, that's the goal. That's what I'm looking for. And I just assumed that some like singer actor was, some singer turned actor was gonna get it. But the beauty of Lin and his platform is that he's able to make his blessings multiply as Latino director, writer, performer, you know? So he sees me. And when I say he sees me, I mean he fucking sees me. And so, you know, he brought me into this film, and then all of a sudden I realized the full circleness of like Jonathan Larson. I made my Broadway debut in Rent. The first time I saw a black and brown face on the cover of a Broadway cast recording was Rent. You know, working with Lin was the first time I got to work with a cast that was all Latino as well within the Heights. And so it's just beautiful, like the blessing Jonathan gave me were passed down to Lin, which are passed down to me. And now being in this business 20 years, it's like all of a sudden there's repeats in who I'm getting to create with. And there's so much fun and joy in just coming back home to an old friend that allows you to work with such comfort and ease, which then allows you to just focus on the work. Mm-hmm. And for me, I feel like the result was like the best fucking work of my life. I'm so proud of this movie.
And Vanessa, I feel like everybody's known you for so long. And watched you.
This is your first musical.
Which is, yeah, right. We watched you grow up, essentially, in front of our eyes. But here you're playing a character who is largely unknown. You're going back to the roots of what a lot of people feel here and trying to make it in the big city, in the lights. Talk about playing that kind of role now and getting that. And of course, you were in Rent as well.
Yeah, this, hey everybody, this project was really special and felt like I was genuinely going back to my roots because I grew up doing musical theater. I was very shy as a kid. I would hide behind my mom, but I loved performing. I would always sing around the house, dance around the house, and so my parents were like, we gotta like do something with her because she's just performing for us and it's too much. It's just a disaster. So they put me in classes, and in musical theater is where I found myself. It was where I knew that I could hide behind a character, and I knew that I had lines, and that gave me the confidence to speak up. And like slowly that started dribbling down into my own personal life and like allowed me to just open up to the world. And feel way more confident. So being able to do this and play this part where I'm supporting someone that I love, someone who is Jonathan Larson, who we all love so dearly, and Andrew as well, who is just crushing it, seeing my guy come to set every day, doing new things, new Jonathan-isms. I was so there, so happy to be supportive, and just to like sing the harmonies, because oh my god, I love singing harmonies so much. But it was just such a blast. I think this cast, this story, we all know how unique and special and spirit-filling it is for all of us, each in our unique ways. And I think that it really shows because we have a certain magic in all of us that we all get to bring to this with Lin leading the way. It was just like, it's a magic train. It's a magic train, guys.
It is indeed. One thing I love, when I saw this movie, I got a bunch of notifications from Netflix and other things. They send to critics and say, please do not spoil this number, the Sunday number, the Broadway number, which is just phenomenal. So I was not allowed to do that. I still wanted to spoil it, to share it with everybody, because it was one of the most amazing musical numbers I've ever seen. But it so fit here for the love of theater, for the love of Broadway, like nothing I've seen in a long, long time. Can you talk about that particular number? And they've now seen it, so I've got no spoilers here in this room.
Well, listen, this is, and it's doubly poignant in the wake of Steve's passing, of course, but the, Jonathan Larson wrote this love letter to Sunday in the Park with George, his favorite Stephen Sondheim musical, and he only ever performed it as like a one-man show. Like, the only way Jonathan ever heard it was himself playing it at a piano, maybe with Roger Bart singing backup. And I realized as the filmmaker, oh, I get to give him the choir version of this song. the choral version of this song that is, that can be every bit as lush as the end of Act One of Sunday in the Park with George. So how can I build Jonathan Larson's dream choir? And how can I also make it sort of this galaxy brain moment that it's not just the heroes of Jonathan, like Bernadette Peters and Andre DeShields and Felicia Rashad and Cheetah Rivera, but also he has this moment that's bigger than even his imagining, and he's going to see the cast of Rent, even though canonically he has not met them yet. And he's going to see the Schuyler sisters and Beth Malone as Alison Bechdel in Fun Home. And amidst all of that, what to me I think actually the most important part of the movie is when he grabs Freddie and he puts him in the painting, because that's actually what he did, is he took his friends and his community and put them on the same playing field as the legends he loved. So that's always a really sort of poignant part for me. And then, you know, it was also the most stressful 4 days of my life, because we were filming in a pre-vaccine COVID era. I can't get Joel Grey sick. We had the entire crew quarantined for 2 weeks because of the different levels of quarantine people could commit to. We had different levels, and people had to be 6 feet from each other. A lot of what you see is not people there at the same time, and because it wasn't possible. So every master shot you see is actually six shots of different people at different times tiled together. What was supposed to be this like fun, great day on Broadway was like the craziest math problem of our lives. And yet, we were gagging. I think I invited Robin to set, even though he's not in the number. I was like, Cheetah's here, Robin, Cheetah's here. We just had so many moments where, I have to show you, because then we also had our dancers who were quarantined playing all the parts so we could work out the staging. So we have pictures of everyone holding, like wearing signs that say like Bernadette Peters. It was like a receipt filler at the Oscars. So it was both a joy and the most stressful moment of my life.
Yeah, it's amazing. And props to your film editor as well. So good for all of you. I just got to signal that we don't have much more time left, but I have to give you all props. And you can tell, beyond actors and beyond anybody, you know, this movie is resonating, which is really good. And it's a Valentine, definitely, to actors as well. So congratulations to all of you. And they have to go to another thing, so I'm going to let them go up here, and you can just stay seated until they exit here. And thank you guys for coming.
Thank you for seeing movies in the theater. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.